Chapter 22. The Johnson's Life at the Lighthouse. I decided to take a little walk to the lighthouse. As I went out the gate and looked up, I saw the high light encased with a nickel-plated case open on three sides. These sides held three round oval glasses facing toward the ocean. As the sun set, the light was turned on from a small switch station near the door that led to the battery room. There was another switch that could be used, controlled from the house. Inside, the light was a concave magnifying glass that enabled the light to be seen from a distance of 20 miles. It was turned off when the sun rose in the morning. The light took up a floor space of 4 feet, and there was a railing, 1 inch by 4 inches and 2 feet high, enclosed around the square. This was a protection as one walked around it to repair or clean the light. The light had a blinking signal. The lighthouse was about 40 feet high, with a base of 8 feet by 8 feet, set on concrete. A small room was set on the base that housed the generator to illuminate the light. There was a small gas engine to charge the battery during the day. The steps going up to the tower were metal on the side of the building, starting from the left side of the door that opened to the battery room. The lighthouse was on high ground, about 50 feet away from the shoreline. There was a 20-degree slope down to the beach. The beach had many smooth rocks, surrounded with small pebbles. From the lighthouse looking toward Kona, the shoreline was a high precipice of about 50 feet as far as you could see. The formation of the land was volcanic and dry. On the left, the land formation sloped to the beach with a beautiful view. Just about 20 yards before you reached the lighthouse was a small oblong stone fence. No one seemed to know its purpose or who built it. From what I gathered, it was supposed to be a kapu stone wall. If you happened to go inside, death would be the penalty. This was all hearsay. To me, it looked like a place to burn all the trash, and I believe it was for that purpose. I asked Mrs. Johnson, and all she knew was that her husband used it to burn all the accumulated rubbish. After looking around, I decided to take a walk along the beach and see what I could pick up. As I was walking, I looked toward the point where the districts of Puna and Kau meet. The ocean was smooth, but had lots of white caps. I could see many fish by looking through the waves. The seaweed was plentiful, as were the seashells, and there were many large black crabs running among the rocks. I could see that only a few fishermen ever came to fish there. I then walked to the upper plain, a slope of 10 degrees. The walking was not easy because there were many small boulders scattered all over the plain. I believe I walked about 1/2 mile. I came upon an old trail that led back to the lighthouse. I stood on the trail and looked around at the beautiful scenery and imagined that someday people would come there and live. It was the kind of place I would like to own someday. As I walked along, the trail began to slope upwards. I could see the lighthouse within a short distance. I sat down to rest. As I looked around, I noticed a small opening in front of a guava tree loaded with ripe fruit. So I got up to walk over to pick some. The tall grass hid the formation of the land. As I cleared away the grass and walked on the rocks toward the opening where the guava tree stood, it was like an open culvert. When I reached the guava tree, I found I would have to climb it in order to get the guavas, so I decided to do that later. I then came to the entrance of a cave. The opening was walled with rock. I climbed in the wall and noticed that the opening was made to crawl in. I looked inside, and as my eyes became adjusted to the light inside the cave, I could see that the cave was high enough to stand up in. I did not want to go in and search, because it was a strange cave to me. Maybe it was a burial cave that some of the Hawaiians used. While standing on the stone wall, I turned around and found guava trees all around me with fruit easy to pick. I got two ripe guavas, came down from the stone wall, and walked out to the trail. I sat down on a rock and ate my guavas. Something told me to see what was inside the cave, but I felt that it was not important. It was getting dark, so I started walking toward the lighthouse. The cave was still on my mind, but my intuition told me not to bother. As I was walking down the hill, I could see that Mr. Johnson had come home because his pickup truck was in the garage. I also saw a big dog, probably a German Shepherd, at the gate watching me. I was a little frightened at first. As I arrived near the gate, the dog began to growl, and I heard Mr. Johnson calling him to come into the house. Mr. Johnson came out to meet me. He was glad that I had come to see him and the family, and he made sure I was staying for the week. He said, "When a visitor comes to stay, it is something special to me, as it makes me forget the loneliness of the work here as a lighthouse keeper." When we walked into the house, I could see that supper was ready, and his helper, Domingo, was already eating. So I went in and washed up before coming to the table. Mr. Johnson introduced me to his helper, a mechanic by trade. I sat next to Mr. Johnson at the table, and he asked me all kinds of questions regarding the family and what I was doing. I gave him all the answers and brought everything up to date. After dinner, Mr. Johnson and I went into the parlor as Mrs. Johnson and the little girl cleaned up the kitchen. Mr. Johnson told me that his recreation was fishing. He would take his catch to the Shimizu Hotel, where he was paid 17 cents a pound for it, and he and his helper were also given a nice lunch. They did this every other day to keep busy. When there was a good show, he took the family to Na'alehu, and they would have supper at the Shimizu Hotel. After the show, he would have a cup of coffee, and Mrs. Johnson and the little girl had apple pie and ice cream at the coffee shop. Domingo took care of the lighthouse when they were away. Sometimes Domingo went with Mrs. Johnson, and Mr. Johnson stayed home to take care of the light. This was their life at South Point. I noticed that night that it was really dark, as there was no moon. Later in the evening, we had a snack of coffee and chocolate pie or cake. Then Mr. Johnson asked me if I was too tired to go fishing just around the corner where the precipice started. He said the waves came up to the precipice, and that is where he caught all his fish. I was eager to see what their catch would be. After dinner, Domingo prepared the equipment to go fishing. He came into the parlor and said he was ready to go. I got on my jacket and took my flashlight, and we started out. As we walked down around the house, we came to the precipice. It was all dry, and the breakers were about 20 yards out. The rocks were dry. Domingo had a bright light strapped on his hardtack hat, with the battery in his coat pocket. He walked about 100 yards and stopped. Mr. Johnson said, "This is the place where we will do our fishing. It will only take about an hour, and our gunny sack will be full with the red fish called uu. The scales are large and hard and easy to clean. It's a good eating fish, and the hotel man wants all that I can get." All they had were two short poles about 10 feet long and five hooks attached in a straight line 4 inches apart, with a white string that hung down about 3 inches. All they did was throw the line and hooks in the ocean and wait. In a second, the white string dangling below the hooks caused the fish to come and nip. By doing so, they nipped the hooks, but most of the time, the fish were caught on their side as they came near the hook. When Mr. Johnson and Domingo felt the fish nip, they pulled up, thereby catching the rest of the fish on the side. This was the fast way of catching the fish. It took less than an hour to fill half the sack, or about 75 pounds. Mr. Johnson told me that other nights he may get only 20 pounds of fish. Whatever he caught, he he put in his freezer, and the next day he took them to the hotel. But the night that I was with him was a really good catch. After about an hour, we started home on the same trail, and I could see the waves near the precipice. Mr. Johnson said in another hour it would be covered. There was another road to go up the precipice, but it would be a long walk back to the house. When we reached home, Mrs. Johnson took 3 red fish and scaled them for boiling with Hawaiian salt. After they were cooked, she poured the fish in a bowl. They were good eating with poi. I believe it was about 3 o'clock when I went to bed and woke up about 8 in the morning. Mrs. Johnson had breakfast prepared. I asked her where her husband was. She told me he and Domingo had left to take the fish to the hotel. They also had to pick up parts for the engine in the lighthouse, and they would be back by noon or a little after. After breakfast, while Mrs. Johnson was doing the washing, I asked her, "How about living here? Don't you feel uneasy? I just want to know your reaction." This is what she told me. "When I am here alone, sometimes I think I see someone here, usually a woman. But I think it is only me, as I am alone so much. And when I am not busy, I have all kinds of imagination. I think this is what happens. I have not told my husband, as I don't want him to worry." I told her, "I don't feel anything here, and I feel free. If there is something here, I would feel it. I know there is nothing to be afraid of." She told me she was glad that I felt the same, and said, "Now I know it is my imagination." I told her what I was doing during my spare time. "I want to write, and not try to take the artifacts with me. As long as I see and like to write what happens, that is enough. I know this Hawaiian ku'ula is dangerous if you try to keep it and believe it will help you in your work. This I don't want to do. All I am interested in is to write the story. I have the same idea as told by my father, which is, just don't try to believe what the Hawaiians do because it is bad medicine. Believe the haole god and you will be saved. I feel the same." I spoke to her about the cave I found up on the hill as I was walking home the day before, and added, "As I stepped down from the stone wall, I had the feeling that someone was saying, 'Come in and see what is in here.' So I stopped for a minute, saying to myself, 'I may come and see later.' The feeling was really strong, and I felt there must be something in there that they want me to take. As I walked away, the feeling got less and less, and when I reached here, everything was forgotten. Just now, when I began to ask you questions, the same feeling was back, to go and see. There must be something in there that they want me to see. I will ask Haneli Ku if he knows what makes me have the urge to go into the cave. Funny, now that I have spoken Haneli Ku's name, I don't seem to have the same feeling. Everything seems back to normal. I will stop at Haneli Ku's when I return to Na'alehu." The time had passed so fast that it was almost lunchtime. Mrs. Johnson went into the kitchen to prepare lunch. After lunch, I excused myself and went into the parlor, sat in the lazy chair to rest, and in a few seconds, fell fast asleep. When I woke up, Mr. Johnson and Domingo were home and eating lunch. I sat at the table to keep them company. Mr. Johnson told me he met Mr. Kupahu and told him I was visiting. Domingo stood up and excused himself as he wanted to repair the motor that turned the generator. Mr. Johnson told him to go ahead and he would help later. Then he asked me what I had done while he was at Na'alehu. I told him I was talking to his wife about different things about life in South Point. I asked Mr. Johnson how he liked it there. He said, "I like it. There is not much recreation, but we have enough work that can keep us busy all day long. By the same token, You can do nothing all day.